What's going on, my fellow APlusers? Welcome back once again to a brand new episode of APlus Morphinominal, your stop for your Power Rangers and Super Sentai review and news right here on our YouTube page. It is I, as always, your Morphinominal host, Adam Perez, back once again, ladies and gentlemen, as we're set to go ahead and get into Kiramager episode number 25, ladies and gentlemen. We have definitely hit our halfway point for this particular series, and this episode specifically feels like sort of a halfway point episode, if you will, like the turning of a new chapter. Things are starting to get even more serious around these Kiramager parts than even I was certainly expecting, but after watching this week's episode, I cannot wait to see how the remainder of this series is certainly going to go. I was already pleased with how this series certainly already was, but now that we have a little bit more of a heightened sense of danger, brand new villains that we're kind of introducing in here, seeing our Kiramagers really with their backs up against the wall, this really makes me eager to see how the rest of the season is certainly going to unfold, and really just what's going to happen for our Kiramagers going forward and how they really bounce back from all this. So I'm super eager to go ahead and talk about this particular week's episode, ladies and gentlemen, but I definitely want to know your thoughts. Just remember, guys, these are always my A-plus opinions. At the end of the day, though, I definitely want to go ahead and know yours, so please let me know your thoughts on this week's episode in the comment section box below, ladies and gentlemen. So listen, I hope you guys had a fantastic weekend. It is in fact Tuesday morning. Happy Toku Tuesday, everybody. We do have ourselves a Kamen Rider Saber review that's going to be dropping for you guys also later on today, so definitely go ahead and look out for that. So we definitely have some great new content coming out for you guys this week. I hope everybody enjoyed their weekend. Listen, I know Saturday we had not only our live episode of APlus Morphinominal that we do every Saturday at noon Central Time, but we also did a live stream reaction to Hasbro's PulseCon for the Power Ranger panel on Saturday as well. That live stream was a little rocky for our internet connection, unfortunately. We literally just went like an hour and a half, 2 hours live earlier that afternoon. And when we came back to go live, my internet was like, you know what, Adam, you can't have nice things today. So it definitely made our live stream for the Power Ranger panel a little bit difficult, but it is available on our YouTube page if you do want to go ahead and check out the debauchery that it certainly was. I tried to do my best, guys, so I definitely apologize in regards to that. But it seems viewership-wise, we're almost at like 1,000 views for the video, so people clearly keep coming back for more or to certainly keep watching it. I'm glad it doesn't have any more dislikes than it already does, quite honestly. So thank you very much for everybody's understanding and patience, and I hope your Saturday was as fun as it was for me, guys. I mean, from the Dino Fury cast to the Beast Morphers Q&A was fantastic. We talked a little bit on Saturday about Zinkager, the upcoming Super Sentai series as well, guys. So, yeah, a ton of stuff this past weekend for us to certainly enjoy, and hopefully another fun-filled week, ladies and gentlemen. So let's go ahead and get into Kiramager episode number 25. First and foremost, guys, real quick before we do, though, if you want to go ahead and subscribe to the channel, please do yourselves a favor. Hit that subscribe button along with that bell notification. If you want to find us on social media, you can do so right here at APlus Opinions. We are on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and Twitch for you gamers also. And of course, every weekend when we do our live show on Saturdays, we like to take live viewer questions. If there's any questions that you certainly might have for me throughout the week based off of just some of your questions or news or articles that drops throughout the week and you want to ask more questions about it, feel free to go ahead and submit them to APlus Morphinominal, just like it is here on the screen, guys. APlus Morphinominal, APlus Morphinominal, @gmail.com. Feel free to go ahead and submit your live viewer questions, and we'll definitely go ahead and tackle those on our Saturday live shows at the end. So, guys, let's get into episode number 25. Listen, the kickoff to this episode I thought was great in regards to us now at least having a new plan or a new trajectory as to where we can see some of these characters going, right? We come to find out that our Kiramagers are still hunting for the Granterstones. That's been one of the questions that we've kind of been asking ourselves is, now that Mabushina has been saved, do we still need the Granterstones, right? Is there a purpose for still hunting them down? I personally personally was really hoping that they certainly would. So to come to find out that yes, they are still hunting the Granterstones, I thought was a brilliant idea. I wasn't sure if Garza was going to try and get into the mix a little bit, maybe try and get the Granterstones for himself. Still up in the air, but we'll see what happens when it comes to Garza. But great decision to continue their treasure hunt, if you will. And we come to find out that now Taka has a brand new mission to use these Granterstones. And that is, in fact, the new wish to restore planet Crystallia. And if you ask me, based off of just Taka's past, I'm pretty sure there's probably a lot of guilt on Taka's mind for him not being there when the attack wind up happening. Let's try and restore to its brilliance, right? So I think that's a great idea here from Taka to want to use the Granterstones to bring back planet Crystallia. We also see that Juru and Tommy Tomo wind up joining him for this particular search. And one of the very first stops that they go on here is to a shrine that is very familiar to Juru. It's apparently a shrine that he used to come to when he was younger. He used to draw a ton of inspiration from this place. He used to draw certainly while he was there. And even became friends with the priestman that lives at that shrine as well, who they wind up bumping to in the beginning here of this episode. So really great to not only see an aspect of Juro's past that influenced him a little bit also, but to see that their travels have led them there, because apparently, according to the priestman, the legend of that area really surrounds the idea of a phoenix, which we get to see Juro has in fact like drawn pictures of, has gotten inspiration from also. And to be honest with you, like the phoenix is probably one of my favorite sort of mythological creatures, if you will. I've always just loved the story about the idea of, like, you know, burning to ashes and then kind of being resurrected with like brand new life and stuff. And I think the priest even gives a perfect example of one of the legends. I believe of like one of the older soldiers from back in the day that wind up coming to this particular area, became resurrected and continued on with his fight. And I believe it's one of the legends that wind up sticking around for that area. But what we come to find out is that that area really thrives off of one of the Granterstones that they're actually hunting for in here, as we wind up discovering the third Granterstone here this week, called Energia, I believe is what more you wind up calling it. Pretty much just letting us know that its prime focus really is energy. It really boosts people's energy, if you will, or it, surrounding objects or whatever the case may be. So they do believe that the idea of this Granterstone Energia, having been in that particular location, is probably was what fueled so many legends of like resurrection and rebirth, if you will. So the Granterstone certainly plays a big part in regards to like this legend of the Phoenix and all that good stuff out there. So I love all the connective tissues that they wind up having here with the legend, the Phoenix, and the Granterstone. But if there is anything that really jumped out at me, especially on this treasure hunt, guys, I've come to realize that I love this threesome, but I love this like trifold of friends, if you will, that we have here with Juru, Tommy Tomo, and Takamichi. The levels of enthusiasm and energy is just off the charts here, man. Like when they find the Granterstone and they're all cheering, they're like, yeah. And then you get Tommy Tomo who like runs up and he's like, look what we found. And they're like just raising up Takamichi's arms like, it got lit. It got so lit. Like, I want to hang out with these guys if I ever get the opportunity to, because they look like they had so much fun, man. I mean, fun is probably just like, it doesn't even begin to explain just the levels of enthusiasm that these three were certainly experiencing. But this is a combination that I truly love. And I kind of feel bad because I really want sort of Shiguru to kind of be a part of that group. But Shiguru and Seo have always kind of been, you know, connected in that sense, or I don't want to say the odd ones out, because clearly our main three has always been Sina, Juru, and Tommy Tomo, right? I feel like those are our main three. So now that we don't have Shiguru around, but we've got Takamichi in the fold, I think they make a great sort of trio, if you will, and I hope that we get to see them again, because their energy was just all over the place, and I was here for it here in this week's episode. Like, I love seeing the Shiny Breaker continues to grow throwing me over and over again, especially when he's doing the drilling. I think the special effects for the drilling were great. And I love seeing Juru with his little shovel again. We've seen him once before going on a treasure hunt with Tommy Tomo, bringing his shovel. But now he's putting his shovel to use and like trying to shovel stuff while we got Taka just over here with his drill. And I love this trio. And this is a trio I didn't know that I wanted until I actually saw it. And yeah, I'm completely on board with it, honestly. Real quick honorable mention here this week. Worst Marsk Beast ever. And it's funny because not only do I think that, but clearly Garza does as well, right? Like Garza has almost had it up to here with just some of the most absurd Marsks that we've seen, honestly. And Carantula continues to think that he's upping his game and making his monsters more and more powerful, but he's really just making them more and more goofy, honestly. Like if Garza could roll his eyes, he probably would, especially for this week's monster, the Bomb Marsk, whose bombs only explode when he hits a strike. So he's got like some of these civilians like stacked up in front of him like bowling pins. He knocks 6 or 7 of them over and his thing doesn't explode. Like the idea is he's got to hit all 10 of them. He's got to get his strike. But the problem with that is that when he does hit the Kiramagers when he knocks them all down with his bomb bowling ball, if you will, because of the fact that there's only 6 of them, it's not a complete strike. They still consider it a spare. So he needs 10 Kiramagers in order for any of his bombs to even work or explode. I mean, come on, Carantula, what are we doing here, man? And like Garza walks off like this is just the dumbest thing I've ever seen in my life. So no go for the Bomb Marsk this week. But thank the heavens, we do have ourselves a formidable enemy here in this week somewhere. Let's go ahead and talk about this cute priestess that just got Tommy Tomo just wrapped up in a ball of feelings this week, man. I've never seen Tommy Tomo act this way. It's almost like something came over this man the moment that he wind up seeing this cute priestess behind the shrine. Now, originally, I thought that she was with the priest at the shrine. I thought the priest was aware of who she was, but even the priest had no idea. He was like, who is that? Oh, I have no idea. She apparently comes and goes as she wants to. Like he turns around when they're getting ready to leave and she's vanished. He has no idea where she went to. So the mysterious cute priestess who winds up popping up at the shrine definitely gets Tommy Tomo's attention for sure. I mean, he's all up in her face asking her questions. I mean, he's just like staring at her like it's almost like he's never had a girlfriend before. Like he's never been around a girl so pretty in his entire life. Like he just cannot handle himself. It's actually pretty adorable, honestly, like coming from somebody like Tommy Tomo, just because we haven't really seen him showcase that side of him, getting all like, you know, getting those butterflies inside of him, you know what I mean? We've never really seen him act that way. But I did love just his love at first sight, if you will, and Takemichi having a little bit of fun at it. But when it comes to the cute priestess here, she's as emotionless as they come. She almost kind of reminds me, I don't know if you guys are familiar with the actress Summer Glau. Summer Glau most notably is known for her time on the show was Firefly, I believe the sci-fi television show Summer Firefly. She was also in the movie Serenity, which was a movie based off of Firefly. She also played in, she was the Terminator for the Sarah Connor Chronicles, if you will. She was also Ravager, I believe, in the Arrowverse for a brief period of time. So when I see this actress that plays this cute priestess, that's who she reminds me of. Like Summer Glau has this way of really coming across emotionless if she wants to, like just the look on her face, right? The big glassy eyes, the no expressions and things like that. She does it well, very much like a Terminator, if you will. And so that's exactly who this actress reminds me of. I have to figure out what her name is, but I love just the intensity and just the creep factor that she winds up bringing to this episode, right? Not really raising her voice too much, not really being expressive, just kind of sitting back and watching watching and seeing how people are reacting to certain things that are going on. And then when it is, in fact, her move to strike, then this is where we really start seeing her connections and really where she's coming from. So you want to talk about powerful villains? I mean, she's commanding those like Garza and Carantula in here, right? Letting her voice be heard, really sent to Earth here, if you will, from Emperor Yodon himself. I mean, she even says, like, you know, she commands the authority that anybody else would, that, you know, from Emperor Yodon himself. So people need to take notice. She is, in fact, the secretary, I believe is what they referred to her as. I'm surprised they didn't say like second in command, general, captain, whatever the case may be. But she's like his right-hand man, if you will, Emperor Yodon's secretary, and come to find out that her name is Yodanna as well. So think of Madonna, but Yodanna. So Yodon and Madonna together equal Yodanna. That's exactly who we wind up getting in here. But I love it. I truly love it. So I said, Q Priestess comes up with a few surprises of herself, creates a Kiramage changer using dark energy, right? Once she winds up starting to truly sort of make her move, I put the secretary of Emperor Yodon and her commands carry his authority with her. I love the costume, honestly. I really do think that she looks absolutely amazing. It claims the idea that Yodon is sort of tired of sitting back and waiting and kind of wants to get into the action a little bit. So this is Emperor Yodon sending Yodanna in to kind of do his dirty work, if you will. So we now have another villain on the board. And for me, that's really exciting. Like, not that I was getting bored with Carantula and Garza, but, you know, we haven't really heard much reference or mention of Emperor Yodon for quite some time since the series began. So for a while, I was thinking to myself, like, is there even a bigger villain after these two that we certainly have to worry about? And the answer is yes. The answer is definitely yes. And so for me, I like the idea that, look, we've hit our halfway point. You know, the big honcho, if you will, when it comes to villains-wise, has sat back, seen how things are turning out, doesn't necessarily like it so much, and wants more things to certainly take place and happen to bring some more pain to the Kiramagers. And he sends her in, and I think it's a really great statement. And you could immediately see just how quickly everything turns on our Kiramagers. So not only do they have to deal with Yodanna now, but they also have to deal with a Monstone that wind up popping up in here during their dig. I think they were trying to look for the fourth Granterstone in here also, and they run across a Monstone who winds up actually absorbing their Energia, the third Granterstone. And so now that he's absorbed it, it's done its job and has given him a ton of abilities and a ton of power. So now we've got a Monstone on the loose that's kicking the hell out of the Gigant Driller. So we already have a new monster, if you will, that's actually more powerful than one of their most powerful mechs also. So everything is stacked up against our Kiramagers finally. And not only that, but we now have zombie muddies also. Like, the fact that Yodanna came in, took her whip, and trust me, that's a whip, guys. She just whipped the hell out of these muddies and turned them all into zombies. Like, they just continue to come after you. Reminds me of something out of The Walking Dead or like 28 Days Later. Like, the zombie strain you would not want to be living in. Like, in that, like, if a pandemic happened or an outbreak happened, right? Those are the type of zombies you would not want to try and survive in. I feel like if a zombie outbreak were to happen, you hope that they're dumb and slow, right? Nothing that's like built off of rage and energy and it's just gonna run you down for hours. Nah. That's what the Kiramagers have to deal with right now with these brand new zombie muddies. They do not let up whatsoever. So shit just got real, guys. Shit just got real in this season. And Yodanna is letting them know, hey, I plan on using some dark energy in here to create a tunnel between our worlds so that my Emperor and Yodon can start just sending in floods of Marsk beasts, guys. So we have some issues on our hands when it comes to the Kiramagers, and hopefully they're going to have to try and find some sort of solutions, and rather quickly. I think the addition of Yodanna in here is a breath of fresh air, to be quite honest with you. It easily perked me up while I was watching this episode. Like, who is this mysterious character? Like, man, she is a cutie, but she is dangerous. Getting to single-handedly take down Tommy Tomo, unleash these zombie muddies and stuff. Yeah, she's definitely coming with some fear. And Carantula clearly is pretty terrified of her as well. So we'll see what happens with Garza. I will be fascinated to see what Garza's relationship is going to be like. Is that going to interfere with some of maybe Garza's own particular personal plans? Or is somebody like Garza and Yodanna going to get along easily? You know what I mean? So, and I will say this in regards to Yodanna. And we've talked about this also when we did our Go Buster reviews or our reactions for Go Busters. There is something about a human villain that brings an element of just heightened worry for me. Like, there's always there's something different than seeing a villain that's just hidden behind a mask, no sort of facial expressions, mouth barely moves sort of thing. You know what I mean? But when you get to see a villain that's actually in human form, there's something that just heightens their importance simply because of the fact that you can see all the expressions that they're making, right? You can clearly feel their anger. You can see their anger and their passion for wanting to destroy you sort of thing. So I think there is just a heightened level of importance when we do get to some of these villains that tend to be human, because there's something more tangible that you can kind of grasp onto. You know what I mean? And I think that's one of the reasons why I loved Enter and Escape so much, was because of that, because they were so expressive and you can clearly tell what somebody was struggling with or dealing with or trying to overcome. Like, there is something important, I think, about having a villain that is able to make expressions and really let themselves be showcased, if you will, and shown when it comes to all these different levels of emotion. Because right now I'm worried for our Kiramagers. I really am. I'm so eager to kind of see where this pushes them, because one of the things that I've always said is I don't like the idea of our teams getting power-ups just for the sake of power-ups, right? Like, I want to see our team get power-ups because something has fallen in front of them that they cannot overcome, that there's this powerful obstacle and now they need all the help that they can get. And if there is any time for a power-up, guys, now is probably the perfect time. So listen, I love the introduction of Yodanna in here. I love just the mystery behind her, the added creepy element in here, how powerful she certainly is. And I think she's going to add a really great dynamic to the remainder of the shows, especially when it comes to the villain side of things. But overall, guys, I was really impressed with this week's episode. Great to see that there is a plan for the Granterstone certainly going forward. So that story certainly continues. Emperor Yodon has certainly made his presence known also in this particular episode, and we're on our way towards the finale, guys. So I will say this one quick last honorable mention: if there was anything that kind of went off in my head light bulb wise that made me ask some questions here in the beginning of this episode, the priestman references to Juru, that Juru is the second person that's sort of fallen in love with that shrine area, that used to come by as often as he did. Now, they didn't necessarily come out and explain who that particular person was, because Juru was like, I'm the second. Well, who's the first? And then the priestman says, you know, most people wouldn't believe me, but an alien. And he says an alien, and then it stops there, and then we immediately go talking to the priestess or the Q priestess. I don't believe that that's who the priest was talking about, because of the fact that Juru spent so much time there. I would assume it's somebody else that also spent so much time there, and considering the fact that the priest didn't seem to know who this cute priestess was, makes me wonder, who was he talking about? Is this somebody else that we've yet to be introduced to, maybe in the second or third part of this storyline, this story arc? Who certainly knows? But I'm really fascinated to see exactly who this alien creature is that the priest certainly was referencing. But overall, guys, we've got some new characters for us to look forward to and find our Kiramagers in a really terrible predicament. But I want to know what you guys thought about this excellent episode this week. So please let me know your thoughts in the comment section box below, ladies and gentlemen. So with that, that will certainly go ahead and wrap it up for us today. Oh, you know what? Actually, before I do, I believe Blossom might have went ahead and actually sent us an email at APlus More Phenomenal. Yes, Toku Tuesday, live comments and questions. She says, looks like Tommy Tomo's fallen in both love and heartbreak all in one day, huh? He's not as much on of a dingus as I used to think. He's growing on me, but I still think Jiro's cuter than he is. Other than that, I felt terrible for Tommy Tomo. I didn't feel necessarily terrible for Tommy Tomo. Like, for me, I mean, I was glad that he finally saw a girl for the first time. I'm like, he acts like he's never been in love or like he's never been in a relationship. I mean, who knows? Maybe Tommy Tomo hasn't had that sort of love at first sight sort of experience, right? Because he was like all heart eyes the entire way, to be quite honest with you. There's some great shots too, like when other people are talking in the scene and it just cuts over to Tommy Tomo and Yodanna, and he's just sitting there like just looking at her, man, like just eyes fluttering. He's completely in love, completely in love. You also say, wasn't that Yodan girl creepy when she stuck out her tongue or what? Yeah, I don't know what's going on with the, super creepy, but I'm here for it, man. I'm here for it. Again, she truly reminds me of Summer Glau in a sense of being able to bring across that creepy, expressionless sort of vibe about her. There is not only a mystery, but like an uncertainty about her. Like, you don't know what her true intentions are, what her true plans are. It's almost like you literally have to watch your back when it comes to her, man. So I cannot wait to see what she winds up doing here. She says, some of the best parts about the episode, Tommy Tomo being seen in other girls' light, in a whole other light. Like I said, he's not much of a dingus as I thought. She says, Drew's flashback of when he first drew my favorite mythical bird. Oh, it's your favorite mythical bird too. Mine too. I love the phoenix. You also say Drew's character song being as cool as I imagined. Oh, that's right. You said I couldn't stop listening to it. That's right. At the end of this episode, there was a Drew song. I can't lie, Blossom. I don't think I made it all the way through, honestly. But I'm glad that you like it. I'm really glad that you like it. But yeah, other than that, hey, I appreciate you sending in your comments and your questions, Blossom, for Toku Tuesday. So thank you very much for that. But guys, again, I want to know your thoughts in regards to this week's episode. So please let me know your thoughts in the live comment section box below. But other than that, that will certainly do it for us today. If anything, again, we will be back this upcoming Saturday, ladies and gentlemen, live at noon Central Time. So definitely go ahead and join us then. So until next time, do me a big favor. Take care of yourselves. Take care of each other. And of course, keep it APlus. We'll talk to you later. Bye. Kiramage change!